Hey, it's Dr. Amanda with Straightsmile Solutions, straightsmilesolutions.com, and today we're going to talk a little bit more about Anchorage and biomechanics for canine exposure cases. And first of all, I just want to let you know that I do have a canine exposure playlist. We talk about diagnostics, treatment planning, when you need it, when you don't, early intervention. Of course, this is always free, and it's available on my website at straightsmilesolutions.com. You can go to the education tab where we have our free educational videos, or you can go to my YouTube channel. I'm assuming if you're watching that, you're already there. If you scroll down on the homepage, it should be there. Or you can search by keyword canine. So anyways, this is kind of like a really, really nice Anchorage setup. I'm not saying you always have to do this, but I'm gonna talk you through what's going on here. Sorry if my TPA is a little off center. We did a little bit of a graphic design and did okay here. But in any case, so this is basically the mechanics of your canine exposure. Of course, high level. The ultimate goal is to prevent impacted canines. Hey, my daughter has one. They're a pain. I would not want my kid to have one. And I did everything I could to prevent it. I got lucky. You know, we did early intervention. We did the expansion at age 8 like we should have. We consolidated the spaces that we created with the expansion from 7 to 10, 2 to 2, with some phase 1 aligners. Got that going on. So one of the potential impacted canines did autocorrect. We pulled out CNH, upper C's. That's the things you got to do. Besides what you do there, there's nothing else you can do besides pray. And sometimes it's just, that's just genetics. That's how it is. One of them's going to be stuck. So, you know, you can do the canine exposure surgery. We did ours with Invisalign. It was a million times harder during the surgery than doing it with braces. So in hindsight, it was something that I wanted to try and I would not do it again. So it just was, oh my God, so much work. This is much, much, much easier. And you can always switch to Invisalign once the tooth is more erupted. And it will work at that point. But this is the mechanics you need for a very, very displaced palatal canine. Now, if it's a super easy one, you might not need this transpalatal arch. The reason why you need the transpalatal arch is for every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. As you bring this forward, the other stuff is gonna bow back. So that's why we put in the transpalatal arch when needed. So the mechanics here is that this is a base wire. Usually for me, it's probably gonna be 1925 stainless steel. Of course, you're going to have to work your way up to that. You do not send for the exposure until all your teeth around it are aligned and leveled. And ideally, there's a little error here in my graphic. There wouldn't be any spaces here. You would already have consolidated all this up. And the only space that would remain is the space that the canine is going to move into. You got your midlines on. Everything is essentially done, except for this tooth is not aligned yet. The bite is corrected. You've already done your expander if you needed one. You've already done your growth modification if you needed one, because there's nothing worse when you get to the end of such a long and arduous canine exposure case, and then we have other stuff to do. And they're like, what? Huh? We're not done yet? You know, this was the goal. So yeah, base wire. This is an overlay 12 nitide piggyback wire, which is a sectional wire. It's not going to go all the way around. It might go a couple teeth mesial, a couple teeth distal. This is definite four-handed dentistry tying this in. It is not easy. But this is really, really, really great anchorage. Very healthy for the teeth and gums. You'll get a great, great outcome if you do this. So anyways, hopefully this was helpful in visualizing what you need for a canine exposure case. Thank you.